Hello and welcome to this special discussion on the wire with Paranjoy Guha Thakurta. Till last week, he was editor of the Economic and Political Weekly, a very well-known, respected current affairs weekly, which also carries scholarly articles, timeless in some sense, and which is indeed EPW is awaited every week by scholars, by academics, and for its current affairs articles, even by normal readers. So the question is, why did Paranjoy Guha Thakurta resign? Now, the reason is that he, along with two other colleagues of his, had done an investigative article on the Adani Group, which related to a duty refund scam, as it were. So it was 500 crore duty refund which the Adanis had claimed, which was based on a certain duty, import duty that they had paid for importing raw materials and consumables for their power plant. So Paranjoy's article essentially exposed the way the Adani Group allegedly claimed a duty refund without paying the original duty. The refund was based on the original duty having been paid. Now, that article created a storm, and the EPW Trust, which manages, Samiksha Trust, which manages the magazine, insisted on taking off the article, which was authored by, one of the authors was Paranjoy. So Paranjoy decided to quit. And the social media has been abuzz with the whole controversy, the reasons why he quit. So we have Paranjoy with us. This is his first interview to any media platform. Welcome to our show, Paranjoy. So we have the privilege of having privilege of having you talk about it firsthand. I believe you haven't spoken about this on any other, at least video TV channel.
Right. Not on the audiovisual medium. Yeah. And I want to thank you, Venu, and I want to thank The Wire, because The Wire, which had republished this article, readers can still access that article and read it and judge it for themselves on your website.
Yeah. So tell us, Paranjoy, what exactly transpired? There's a lot of speculation among avid readers of EPW, which is, as you know, it has a tradition of both scholars writing for it, scholars learning from EPW, and Wire published your piece. So we have a lot of readers and people who access The Wire, and there's a common pool of people who read EPW, who read The Wire also. So a lot of speculation as to why you resigned. Why did Samiksha Trust take off Adani, that article that you published, and what exactly transpired?
Okay, it was in Tuesday, the 12th of July, and I came into that meeting of the Samiksha Trust at approximately around noon, and I was told, and I knew that the trustees, all but two of the trustees, had already been meeting and they'd had a discussion. So the entire meeting lasted for a little over 45 minutes. I remember, because my resignation letter is dated 12:45. After that, there was an informal conversation, of course.
But who are the trustees for our viewers? All right. If you could name them.
The chairman of the Samiksha Trust is Professor Deepak Nair. The managing trustee is Mr. D.N. Ghosh. Among the trustees who were present at that meeting were Professor Romila Thapa, Professor Dipankar Gupta, Professor Rajiv Bhargav, and Professor Shyam Menon. The two trustees who were not present at the meeting were Mr. Deepak Parekh and Professor Andre Bethe. And until Tuesday, the 18th of July, the editor is the member secretary, is the ex officio member secretary. So to summarize what happened that day, I mean, the first few minutes went in discussing what I thought would be the main subject of discussion, but I was clearly unaware of what would transpire, was about a documentary film which is currently in the making on the occasion of the 50 years of the Economic and Political Weekly. All the trustees felt that by seeking the services of a lawyer to reply to a notice, a letter essentially, sent by a lawyer representing Adani Power to the article which me and three others had put together, constituted, to use their words, a grave impropriety and a breach of trust. After the letter had been received, it was sent to me. But you know, all these defamation notices that come, they are sent to the printer, the publisher, the editor, the writer. And in this particular case, the publisher of the Economic and Political Weekly is the Samiksha Trust, which owns it. So it was the Samiksha Trust was named. So the lawyer I engaged represented everybody and gave a reply. And after the lawyer's reply came in and was sent to the Adani Group, or the lawyer representing Adani Power, both these were put on the website of the EPW at the end of the article.
So you published the article.
That's right.
And Adani's lawyer sent a letter. You had the letter replied to by your lawyer, and you put both on the website.
That's right. The lawyer I engaged was Chandrachur Bhattacharya. He's an advocate. Now, the so-called grave impropriety I'm supposed to have committed was that I did not inform the trustees until both the letter by the Adani Group's lawyer and the reply by Chandrachur Bhattacharya had been put up on the website. Not only did I not inform them, I did not seek their prior approval or consent. That was what, according to the trustees...
That's a charge against you.
That's right. They said this is an act of grave impropriety and a breach of trust. In my opinion, this is what I would describe a procedural lapse, for which I apologize immediately. But the point is that all these letters, they name everybody, printer, publisher, editor, writer, and in any case I would have to reply. But what I found very, very
but the Pranjay, the entire debate, the question that people are asking is not about your procedural lapse. The question people are asking is, why did the trust pull down the article on Adani written by you and your colleagues?
All right.
That's a substantive issue.
Absolutely.
Right?
Okay, so let's go sequentially. First they said that I had committed a grave impropriety and a breach of trust. Then they said they were seeking to codify rules and guidelines to specify what should be the engagement of the editor with the trust and the trustees. I was told that they were seriously looking at the possibility of hiring a co-editor. And then they said this article is to be pulled down from the website with immediate effect.
Did they tell you why?
They did not tell me why. And they also said, do not leave this room until we have ascertained that the article has been pulled down. So I called up my colleague.
I believe they did not even tell you that they found the article per se libelous or anything of the kind.
The most amazing part of that entire interaction, that we didn't discuss the article. We discussed, they kept referring to it, the lawyer's letter, as a defamation case. And I kept trying to explain to them, a letter from a lawyer does not amount to a defamation case.
The letter did not mention any kind of defamation or criminal defamation.
No, they did. They said you have defamed our client, and that is Mr. Gautam Adani, who heads the Adani Group of Companies, of which Adani Power Limited is a part. Wait, but the point is, they kept saying it was a defamation case. I said nobody has moved any court of law. And I kept saying one point, and this is where it was, you see, after everybody spoke, I was given a little bit of time to give my views. Regretfully, it was very little time. I would have liked to explain many things to them. And one of the things that's very important to understand, that you know in India, defamation is both a criminal offense and a civil offense. But in either case, whether it's a court is moved, citing the provisions of the Indian Penal Code and the Criminal Procedure Code, whether it's a civil offense or an alleged civil offense or an alleged criminal offense, truth is your best defense. And I kept saying, I stand by every single sentence, every single word, every single line that's been written. But it seemed to me that the trustees were not interested in that aspect of it. Let me finish. They said they'd lost their faith in trusting me. That over the last 15 years...
So you're saying that they didn't discuss the substantive question that your article had pointed out or had outlined?
Absolutely. And no, one minute. The last point that I wanted to make is, after they said, first, they'd lost their faith and trust in me, and this was, they said they're going to look at appointing a co-editor, that they also looked at having this set of guidelines to determine how the editor should interact with the trust. Then they told me, you must pull down that article now with immediate effect. They also said, you cannot write any article under your name, under your byline, a signed article, presumably without the prior permission of the trust. So at that point of time, I asked for a piece of paper and I said, here's my resignation. It was around 12:45 on Tuesday, the 18th of July, 2017. And I said, I request you to please accept.
So you're saying that they told you that if you wanted to write an article, you had to take prior permission of the trust?
That's correct.
Under your name?
That's correct.
But was that the EPW's tradition earlier?
I was hearing all this for the first time. So I said, I've got the message. Yeah. I said, I can read the writing on the wall. I've got the message. So I asked for a piece of paper. I unfortunately wasn't carrying my resignation letter in my pocket. So I said, please give me a piece of paper. And I wrote down those two lines, said, please accept my resignation with immediate effect.
Do you feel that they had made up their mind that you should resign?
You know, I can't second guess what their thoughts were. I have summarized for you the sequence of events and what transpired at that meeting. I mean, this question as to whether they had made up their mind or not made up their mind, it's a question only.
And before this, you didn't have any other run-ins with the trust members?
What you describe as a run-in, I wouldn't describe it that. There were a number of meetings of the Samiksha Trust where I were present. There were differences of opinion. There were various discussions.
No, why I'm asking this question is, from what you have described, that crucial meeting that you had with the Samiksha Trust members, it seems to me that the kind of demands that they were making on you, that they had already kind of made up their mind, or they wanted a change of editor. So is it something that had transpired before? Were they generally uncomfortable with the kind of corporate investigations that you were doing? Because you'd been doing a lot of them even prior to that.
Not just
the Adani, you'd done several other corporate investigations relating to other big corporate groups also, right?
Absolutely correct. I have books on the subject.
The SR Group, the Anil Ambani Group, their import.
Not the SR Group, the Ambani Group. The Reliance Group. Wait, Venu, when they informed me that I was going to be appointed as the editor of the Economic and Political Weekly on the 24th of January 2016, my track record, my past, whatever I had done or not done was known not just to the trustees, to the whole world. All right? In the period, over the last 15 months that I served as editor of this prestigious journal, there were at least 20 odd articles which had been published in this period of time.
During your 15 months?
That's correct. And some of them were web exclusives, web only, some of them were both print and web, but these were all articles that looked at different aspects of the nexus between big business and politics.
Basically crony capitalism.
Yeah. And the point that you have to note, that though...
That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, the point is, not a single fact has been denied. You can have an opinion that this is badly
written.
And you
never received a single legal notice
No.
from a lawyer in the past?
Before the EPW?
No, in the course of your 15 months,
no,
you said you've done over 15 such articles, corporate investigations.
More than that, 20 of them.
20 of them, and never any legal notice?
No, no. Okay. Earlier, I had received legal notices, but never during the time I was the editor of the Economic and Political Weekly from the 4th of April 2016 till the 18th of July.
So I'm asking, do you think this might have made them uncomfortable since you, during your tenure, 20 corporate investigations had happened?
They'd all dealt, had something to do with the corporate sector, something to do with the government, something to do with the Nexus. Look, Venu, you've got to ask this question to the trustees.
Sure.
If they were uncomfortable, I wasn't informed. If they felt that this is not what I should be doing, I wasn't explicitly told. We've had discussions on various issues, on various subjects.
So you felt there was a certain abruptness about that meeting that you had with the Samiksha?
Absolutely. I must tell you.
It came as a bolt from the blue to you.
I was certainly taken aback.
You're not anticipating any of it.
Certainly not. I was taken aback. I was under the mistaken impression that meeting was convened largely to discuss the documentary film that is currently under production to mark the 50th anniversary of the EPW. That's right. But clearly I was mistaken.
Also, I'm told one of the trustees, who also happens to be a sociologist, had raised some objection to an article that was published in the EPW by another sociologist, who was very critical of the whole discipline of sociology and the way it was being practiced in India, the elitism of the sociological, academic discourse, etc. Was that just a sideshow, or was that also part of this cumulative angst that the trust might have had?
If I name names, I will be accused of committing a breach of privilege, because whatever transpired in that room that morning or early afternoon was supposed to be a privileged interaction. Be that as it may, okay. Since you've raised this question, let me say.
No, I've raised it because I've learnt about it.
So. Okay, sure. So let me clarify. The trustees, two of the trustees, argued that some of the articles that I was responsible for publishing were quote unquote scurrilous. So I asked them that, I'm sure you understand the meaning of that word, and I understand, which means a scurrilous is a scurrilous article would mean something that's defamatory, something that's libelous. I don't think I've done anything of that sort. And I said, please tell me which article can be considered scurrilous. So, one of the trustees pointed out one particular article written by Vivek Kumar, which had been published last year, soon after I joined the EPW. This was an article which had been in the pipeline. It had been approved by my predecessor and his colleagues. One second. Be that as it may, since it was published during my tenure, I have to take full responsibility. Now, this article turned out to be a pretty controversial one, because this person had made certain very, very harsh and critical comments about fellow sociologists. And thereafter, after this article was published, others wrote. And EPW has this tradition, once you write an article, then you get others to discuss it and comment on it and criticize it. So that's what also happened. We subsequently published other articles which were critical of this particular article. So my suggestion to you and to all those who are viewing this program and to anybody and everybody, please go to the archives of the EPW, check out this article by Vivek Kumar, and if you consider it to be scurrilous, well, sure, that's your opinion. That was the first time such strong words had been used to describe one article. No other example was pointed out, by the way, and none of the investigations were considered scurrilous, or at least it was not mentioned to me. They may have a different point of view, they may have a certain opinion. Yes.
Okay. So you're saying the word scurrilous was used by the trustees?
That's correct.
Now, coming to the substantive issue, Paranjoy, about the article in question on which you received a legal notice. Now, I read that article very carefully. In that article, you are stating upfront that the Adanis are, in some sense, they have received this bonanza from the government So you are actually holding the government to account.
That's correct.
And you are very clearly saying that you're not faulting the Adanis in the sense you're not saying that the Adanis have committed a crime. It is something that the government has handed to them, right?
Absolutely correct. Venu, the second sentence.
So if that is the case, then why would Adani want to send you a legal notice? The government should send you a legal notice, right?
That's a very good question that you've asked. And I cannot answer this question because only Mr. Gautam Adani or his lawyers or his representatives can answer this question. Mm-hmm. But you're absolutely correct. The second sentence of this article, which is a fairly long article, runs into quite a few thousand words. Mm-hmm. The second sentence of this article clearly and categorically states mm-hmm. that this article does not argue that Adani Power has broken any law. There is no illegality involved.
In fact, you are arguing that the rules were tweaked to help the Adanis.
Absolutely.
In a sense, I just want to simply explain to the readers, to our viewers in just one sentence, what Paranjoy's article is trying to say is that Adanis have got a refund of 506 crores on
refund has been processed.
Adanis have claimed, have claimed a refund of 506 crores on the basis of duties already paid, a duty of over 1000 crores, which the article suggests that duty has not been paid. And Paranjoy is essentially asking the government whether that duty has been paid. Please tell us whether the finance ministry, please tell us whether he has paid the original duty for him to claim the refund. Isn't that what you're asking?
Absolutely. Yeah. And further, Venu.
So what is libelous about this?
1 minute.
I'm not able to understand. What is libelous about it?
I don't think it's libelous. Yeah. I've also further stated that the Gujarat High Court, its judgment was wrong. Or
scurrilous. What is scurrilous about
it? Scurrilous is supposed to be libelous, supposed to be defamatory. If you know, it's something that tarnishes your reputation and so on and so forth. But to return to the substantive part of the question that you asked, this article questions why the Gujarat High Court and the Supreme Court approved this processing of the application for refunds of customs duties to the tune of 506 crore rupees without verifying, without ascertaining whether or not that customs duty had been paid in the first place. So that's the question we raised.
That's the single most important question.
And to the government, to the Ministry of Finance, to the Ministry of Industry and Commerce, we are raising two basic questions. One, is it correct that this application for refunds has been processed without the duty ever being paid? Two, and equally importantly, is it correct that the rules governing power projects in special economic zones were tweaked? It had been tweaked over a period of time during the UPA regime. The last tweak happened in 2016, August, when the Modi government was very much there. The question, were the changes in the rules benefiting one company, Adani Power Limited, located in the Mundra Special Economic Zone? You know, let me use this opportunity, because there have been certain gentlemen who have tweeted, and a person who was also holding an important position in the Economic and Political Weekly, they've raised doubts about a few questions. Firstly, was this tweaking of the rules aimed at benefiting one firm? Now, this is what I asked the government. And because today there is only one power plant of its kind.
And these rules were tweaked during the UPA.
Absolutely. There were a series of tweaks. One second.
So why shouldn't the India government answer? It's a big puzzle to me also.
1 minute. The tweaks were over a period of time. There's a whole list of the tweaks. But the last tweak that happened to enable them to process that refund application happened in August 2016, when the Modi government was very much in power. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the Modi government is responsible for the last set of changes in the rules.
There was a residual changes.
All right. Yeah. Now the point is here. If indeed, you know, people are questioning why this was done to favor. Because there is only one firm of its kind. There is another project in the Mundra Special Economic Zone, another power project, but that power project is being sold. So there is only really one project that benefits. The question, I wrote to Mr. Arun Jaitley, the Minister of Finance. We sent detailed questionnaires to the Revenue Secretary, Dr. Hasmukh.
Nirmala Sitharaman.
That's right, the Minister of State for Commerce and Industry.
Got no replies.
That's right, to the Revenue Secretary, to the Commerce Secretary. It's been more than 1 month. I have evidence that they received my questionnaire and, but why did they not reply? If my facts are wrong, if indeed I've maligned anybody or unfairly tarnish somebody's reputation, why is there this silence? The question I ask to those who say your facts are all wrong, your logic is all wonky, you based your article on a single source. Look, all investigative reports, all your investigative reports, don't they emanate from one source? We took 4.5 months to verify each and every fact. There were four of us who
actually
worked on the story.
Let me interject here.
Yeah.
I concede your point that if the source is a government investigation department itself, then it assumes that much more weight, because the government investigation department would have collected, used all the resources to collect so much material, which is also in another case mentioned in one of your articles.
That's
where
correct.
It says DRI, after this government came, DRI investigated a case of over invoicing of coal and other power equipment by not only Adani's, Anil Ambani Group.
That's
and
correct.
That over-invoicing also runs into some 15,000 plus crores.
Absolutely, more than that.
More than that. So why is the government not, this is government's own investigation department which has come out with this. So why are they not taking action, or why are they not making this public?
This is an excellent question you've asked, and this question can only be answered by Mr. Jaitley.
Because today if you want to do a report on that, you'll be slapped with another legal suit.
That's correct. Wait.
Because the government is not speaking, and the corporates concerned who've been given this bonanza are running after journalists, threatening them with legal suits.
You're absolutely right.
So where are journalists who are doing corporate investigations?
Let's take a step back. The DRI, the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, is the investigation wing of the Department of Revenue in the Ministry of Finance. 1 minute.
Under Mr. Jaitley.
Absolutely correct.
And so Jaitley should have access to all these reports.
Absolutely. So not only is the question of why no action is being taken and why is the government silent on this, there's one other point that I need to mention. Every single line in that article can be authenticated. Let me appear before a court of law, and if required, these documents, this evidence.
So you're willing to appear before a court of law, and line by line, you're willing to sort of substantiate your arguments.
That's absolutely. And you know, to the criticism.
And
that
then one larger point, Paranjoy, where do journalists, publications, very few of them who are doing corporate investigations, I mean, where do they stand today when the government, which is supposed to have investigated all this and have fully investigated reports lying with them, are unwilling to reveal publicly the facts or the information that they've collected on these corporates? And when you manage to get some of those reports from officials and you publish them,
and the corporates
start filing case against you, and the government is quiet. So what do journalists do, and what do publications do in this situation?
See, Venu, why do these reports get leaked? That's because
there are some honest bureaucrats who want this to come out.
Absolutely. And they want the world to know that the government is taking no action.
No action. Yeah.
All right. Now, second point that you mentioned, this legal notice, this letter by the lawyer representing Adani Power, is akin to what is called a SLAP, S-L-A-P-P, Strategic Litigation Against Public Participation. The difference is they haven't moved a court of law. Across the world and also in India, this is a way of intimidating and harassing. My colleague Subir Ghosh and I'm the co-author, we've written a book on the subject. It was published in May 2016.
So is there a legal case pending there also?
No. We released the book in Delhi. A lot of people came. We had a panel discussion. Professor Deepak Nair was in the audience, I know. The title of the book is Sue the Messenger, and the subtitle is How Legal Harassment by Corporates Undermines a shackles reportage and undermines democracy in India. The short point. You know, there are dozens of examples in India and across the world. Of course, there are many, many more examples of how this the lawsuit is used to stifle and intimidate critics. It could be writers, it could be journalists, so it could be social activists. One minute. The whole idea is to send a chilling effect. It's expensive to hire lawyers. It's time consuming. As the long arm of the law can be really long, the wheels of justice can grind very, very slowly, excruciatingly slowly. So this
I can understand what you're saying, but the wire has also been subjected to such litigation.
So you know exactly what I'm talking about. Groups, yeah. Absolutely, you know exactly
so
what I'm talking
about. So tell me finally, Paranjal, what is the alternative? How do media organizations which are serious about this investigation and journalists, few of them, a few media organizations which are indeed serious, how do they deal with this? Because it was a bit disappointing that that EPW buckled, you know. Because no, EPW, there was a wide, they widely expected that EPW would not.
So I must say, it's not just me, a lot of people are deeply disappointed at what has happened. Yeah. And the point is that I'm honored and privileged that over 155, I think close to 200 eminent academics, writers, journalists, activists, including internationally renowned persons like the Nobel laureates, Dr. Amartya Sen, Angus Deaton, Noam Chomsky, and literally a galaxy of writers have publicly expressed their unhappiness and dismay at the manner in which the editor of the Economic and Political Weekly was literally forced to resign by the Samiksha Trust and the board of the Samiksha Trust. Very honestly, Venu, I've been overwhelmed by this response. I didn't expect them. I had nothing to do with it. That spontaneously,
yes, on social media also?
Everywhere. That this it has been so spontaneous that I've been overwhelmed. I've been really surprised, and I just couldn't have imagined that this would be the kind of reaction that I would get, and that's all. So where do people like you and me go? At the end of the day, we've just got to keep on doing at it. I'll tell you honestly, I don't know why this legal notice, some people thought it was important to make a very big deal out of it. For me, I was doing my job. I've been doing this job for a long, long time, for many decades now. I don't want to appear as if either a hero or a martyr, but I think I'm just doing my job. There are people who are saying, you know, you haven't verified your facts. I said, point out the factual error. People are saying these are single source pieces. I said, no, they might come from a single source, but we work on it. There were four of us who worked on this particular story for over 4 months. 4.5 months. So it's not that due diligence is not taken. You can always argue this can be better written, this can be better expressed, but contradict the facts of the case.
Copies can always be refined.
Yeah, sure. I don't have the last word on the subject. And so all kinds of things have been said by all kinds of people. There have been people who've alleged that I voluntarily chose to pull down the article, which is nonsense. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I'm polite to the trustees, they directed me or instructed me. If I'm less than polite, I was ordered to pull it down with immediate effect. And I was told that I would not leave that room until they had ascertained that the article was pulled out. I think after all this, and when I'm told that I cannot write an article in my name in that, I think no self-respecting individual can continue. So people say, did you protest? I said, yes, here's my resignation letter.
Thank you very much, Paranjay, for talking to us. That was Paranjal Guha Thakurta, editor of EPW, who resigned last week in the midst of the controversy that he just told us about, all the details. Thanks for watching.